So today I would like to move gradually towards the theme of this school, namely gravitational waves. So in that context, we are really interested in rapidly spinning neutron stars, hopefully with deformations which are non-axisymmetric. But before that, there are some preliminaries. First of all, let us look at the possible manifestations of a neutron star. The most elementary one, of course, is what we discussed yesterday afternoon, namely that it is a body at a temperature of several million degrees, so it will emit black body radiation. And you estimated yesterday afternoon that this spectrum will peak in the soft X-rays. Now, it took a long time before one had the sensitivity that is required of X-ray telescopes. Now, with Chandra Observatory, you can see lots of neutron stars through their black body emission, some of them many thousands of years old. But more interesting thing is, again, this was one of the problems which we discussed yesterday afternoon, is if matter falls on a neutron star, typically the energy release is 10% of the rest mass energy. I did this for you yesterday afternoon. So if matter falls on it at a rate m dot, then the luminosity is eta m dot c squared. Okay, so as matter falls in, it will emit X-rays. And that this is a way to detect neutron star was predicted by the great Zeldovich long before neutron stars were discovered. But this is not the way neutron stars were discovered actually. Neutron stars were discovered as pulsars. So before we discuss pulsars, let us briefly review elements of radiation theory. You know that an oscillating charge will radiate, and this is the famous Larmor's formula. The energy loss rate is 2e squared by 3c cubed square of the acceleration, and that can be written as the square of the second derivative of the dipole moment. So if the dipole moment is zero, you can only have higher order multipole radiation. Now, if the dipole moment varies as some d0 cos omega t, if I take the second derivative and square it, you will see a fourth power of the frequency will come in. So the characteristic of dipole radiation is that the energy loss rate is proportional to, is monochromatic, and is proportional to the fourth power of the frequency and the second power of the electric dipole moment. Now, a rotating sphere, for example, may not have an electric dipole moment, but it may have a magnetic dipole moment. If the magnetic field is B and the radius of the sphere is R, then you remember from Griffith, the magnetic moment of a sphere is BR cubed. So that same formula that I wrote before applies now, that the luminosity is proportional to now square of the magnetic dipole moment and fourth power of the frequency. Now, a rotating sphere can also emit gravitational... Okay, fine. This is what I meant. Having written a formula like this, I strongly urge you to rewrite the formula like this so that tells you explicitly that the luminosity is proportional to the square of the magnetic field, proportional to the fourth power of the frequency. Now, there will also be gravitational radiation. Now, as you heard yesterday after my lecture, conservation of mass forbids monopole radiation. Conservation of charge forbids monopole radiation in electromagnetism. And as you saw yesterday, the transformation Dr. Hinderer made, that the conservation of momentum of the center of mass forbids dipole radiation. And so the lowest multipole radiation you have is quadrupole radiation, and that's proportional to the third time derivative whole squared. Now, it's worth noticing that both G and the occurrence of C to the power 5 in the denominator make this radiation extremely weak as a matter of principle. Now, I will not say anything more about this. Now let us discuss neutron stars as pulsars. The first dynamo that Faraday made was a uniformly magnetized sphere which was rotating. He discovered that if I rotate a sphere, voltage develops between different parts of the surface, and the maximum voltage by symmetry must be between the pole and the equator. Now, if you take a simple dynamo, like your bicycle dynamo, the voltage you generate is about 5 volts, enough to light a little bulb. But if this sphere is now 10 kilometers in radius, rotating at a period of 1 second, and has a magnetic field of 10 to the power 12 Gauss, the voltage you generate is in excess of 10 to the power 16 volts. So you expect interesting things to happen. And one of the interesting things happen is that the neutron star functions as a pulsar. Now let's try to understand why a dynamo develops a voltage. This is my uniformly magnetized sphere. Imagine one electron inside the sphere. It's going around as the sphere rotates. It's going around a magnetic field. Therefore, it will experience a Lorentz force, V cross B. But an electron doesn't like to experience a force. So what it does is it redistributes charges on the surface so that it creates an electric field such that the force due to the electric field is minus V cross B, which precisely balances the Lorentz force. Okay? So the sphere is clever to create charges so that the net force on every charge in the interior is identically zero. And that's how a dynamo works. Okay? So this is the simplest dynamo. This is called the unipolar inductor, the first one that Faraday built. It's worth noticing that the voltage you generate is proportional to the magnetic field and inversely proportional to the period. So stronger the magnetic field, larger is the voltage. Faster you spin the magnet, larger is the voltage. This will be very important for us when we discuss pulsar. Okay? The other very important thing to appreciate is that you know from Thomson's theorem, if I remember it's called, the inside the sphere, there is no component of the electric field parallel to the magnetic field. Because if I dot this electric field with the magnetic field, the answer is zero. Okay, but there is a component of the electric field parallel to the magnetic field outside the sphere. Here is the expression for the potential, which is quadrupolar. This is the surface charge density. And then by using standard formulae from Griffith or Jackson, you can derive the electric field outside the sphere, and you find that it is non-zero. That's all that we want to know. The electric field parallel to the magnetic field is non-zero. Why parallel to the magnetic field will become clear in a second. Okay, now let us discuss elements of pulsar electrodynamics. Now this is in principle, this is a problem in Landau and Lipschitz electrodynamics book. But this is an infinitely harder problem because the problem you start out with is very simple, but very soon you will develop conditions outside the magnet so that your solution breaks down. And now I'll try to convince you why this is so. First of all, if you generate 10 to the power 16 volts, a charge on the surface experiences enormous electrostatic force. Now you have to compare that with other forces. The gravitational force, the nuclear force, if it's a proton, the nuclear force. Convince yourself that if you have an electric field generated by voltage of the order of 10 to the power 16 volts, then this far exceeds every other force. Therefore, this charge will simply be pulled out of the surface. So it's like having a parallel plate capacitor. You have such a large voltage between the two plates, the charges are pulled out of the plate itself. Okay. So that's the kind of voltage that you're dealing with here. Now, the charges not only are pulled out of the surface, physically pulled out of the surface, and because there is an electric field, they will be accelerated very quickly to ultra-relativistic velocities. Okay. Now, The magnetic field near the surface is very strong, 10 to the power 12 Gauss, 10 to the power 13, 10 to the power 14 Gauss. And therefore, the charges are confined to move along the field lines, because the moment the charge tries to move away from the field line, V cross B force will come in, and this force is so strong that the charges are confined to move along the field lines. So if you want to think quantum mechanically, the orbits of an electron in a magnetic field are quantized. These are called the lambda levels. So the point is, all the electrons will be in the lowest lambda level. So they're like being in the ground state of a hydrogen atom. They cannot go. The moment you try to pull them out, they'll come back in. Okay. So gyration is forbidden. You can gyrate, but very quickly you'll come to the ground state. So you are in the ground state all the time. You are in the lowest lambda level if you want to think of it quantum mechanically. Therefore, accelerated charges have no option but to slide along the field lines. That's why I was interested in whether there's an electric field component parallel to the magnetic field. If the electric field is only perpendicular to the magnetic field, it isn't going to do a thing, because magnetic field isn't going to allow you to move in that direction. Fortunately, there is an electric field component parallel to the magnetic field. So one picture is worth 10,000 words. So the charges that are pulled out will slide along the field lines like beads on a string. And since the field lines are curved, they will radiate. This is not synchrotron radiation. The electron is not gyrating. The electron is moving in a curved railway track. So this is called curvature radiation. This is the only case where I know this radiation occurs. Now, the charges pulled out and accelerated are trapped by the magnetic field, because they can't move away from the magnetic field. They stick to them because of Lorentz force. So what will these charges do? They are trapped in one particular field line. They'll just go back and forth between the North Pole and South Pole, North Pole and South Pole. Okay? This is what happens on the Earth. When there is a solar flare, the charges from the Sun are trapped by the Earth's magnetic field, and they just go from North Pole, triggering an aurora borealis. They go to South Pole, there is an aurora there. North Pole, there is an aurora. You can sometimes see 8 or 10 aurora like this. Okay? So that's what will happen there. So the important thing is that because the magnetic field is anchored to the star, as the star rotates, the magnetic field will also rotate. Therefore, the charges that are trapped in the magnetic field will also co-rotate with the star. You have no option to co-rotate with the star. This is called the magnetosphere of the neutron star. Just as we have the magnetosphere of the Earth, and we have magnetosphere of Jupiter, and we have magnetosphere of Io, which is one of the moons of Jupiter, and so on. So this is a very well-known phenomenon. Except there is a little complication over here. Now, a co-rotating magnetosphere must have a finite extent, because if you go very far away, then this orbital velocity will become greater than the speed of light. Because you have to co-rotate, it's like a cycle wheel spokes. I've attached a bead to the spoke. So the spoke, as the spoke is co-rotating with the neutron star, therefore, if the spoke is infinitely long, at some stage you will reach the velocity of light. Beyond that, field lines will be made to bend due to special relativistic inertial effects. Therefore, what is that radius? The distance at which the circular velocity becomes equal to the velocity of light is C over omega. It's as simple as that, right? See, where omega is the angular velocity of rotation of the sphere. So at that distance, the particle will be going around at the speed of light, which means you have to distinguish between two classes of field lines. Field lines which close inside this distance, and all the charges trapped here can merrily go around without violating special relativity. But if this charge over here in this field line were to co-rotate with the star, it will violate special relativity. So what it will do is, it will not co-rotate, it will say goodbye and just go off to infinity. Okay, so there will be two classes of field lines. all field lines close, but those that close inside this magical distance will form the magnetosphere. Those that close outside will result in particles really escaping to infinity. And that's really what happens. So it was a long mystery trying to explain the polarized radiation from the Crab Nebula, which Sklovsky had predicted would be strongly polarized and so on. And that was resolved when the pulsar at the center of the Crab Nebula was discovered. And what is responsible for this radiation, all the way from radio to high energy gamma rays, are these ultra relativistic particles escaping from the neutron star. Now, radiation from a relativistic charge differs in some fundamental way from radiation from non-relativistic charge. For one thing, radiation from a relativistic charge will be beamed very highly in the forward direction in a narrow cone, and the opening angle of this cone is inversely proportional to the Lorentz factor gamma. Secondly, the radiation will not be monochromatic. The radiation from our old oscillator, an electron going around, will be at the same frequency as the frequency of gyration. But that will not be so in relativity, because imagine there is an electron going around in this table relativistically. Let's take this person here. You will see the radiation only when it is here. You will not see radiation. Again, you will see radiation. So you will see pulsed radiation. Even though the electron is radiating all the time, you will see pulsed radiation. Therefore, the energy is confined in time. Therefore, it is deconfined in the Fourier space. So if you confine radiation in real time, it will spread out in frequency space, right? Fourier transform of a delta function is a constant, right? Or a Fourier transform of a Gaussian is a Gaussian, and the width of the Gaussians are reciprocal to one another, right? So if I localize something in time, it's going to spread out in frequency. So the radiation from a relativistic electron will not be monochromatic. Quantum mechanically, what happens is that classically the Landau levels are equally spaced in energy. So regardless of where they jump from, they will always produce the same frequency. In relativistic quantum mechanics, the Landau levels are unevenly spaced. So you have no fundamental and harmonics coming in, okay? So look it up in your favorite book on quantum mechanics. So now let's go back to the neutron star. So we got up to this point. We said that there's a nice cone of radiation produced right near the surface by electrons which are being pulled out and accelerated along the magnetic field lines. And that will be a narrow cone. So if the magnetic axis and the rotation axis are not aligned with one another, then once every rotation, that cone will hit you. So that is why the radiation from pulsar comes in pulses. Just like the electron that went around on the table is radiating all the time, the pulsar is also radiating all the time. So it's purely a geometrical effect like a lighthouse, okay? Which would not be there if the two axes are aligned, but in case they are not aligned, then you'll see pulses of radiation, one pulse every rotation. But I want to now convince you that the physics is a lot more complicated and interesting than this, because that radiation that you produce is not radio radiation. Pulsars were discovered in radio wavelength. Because the reason is, the radiation that you will produce by the acceleration of this electron will be ultra high energy gamma rays. Because electrodynamics tells you, if I have a charge that is moving in the instantaneous arc, what will be the frequency at which it will radiate? The frequency at which it will radiate will not be the gyration frequency, but gamma cubed times the gyration frequency, where gamma is the Lorentz factor. So even though non-relativistically the electron may be radiating in radio wavelength, gamma cubed times radio wavelength, if gamma is 10 to the power 8, you will get frequencies of the order of 10 to the power 20 or more, which is gamma rays. So what you will produce near the surface of a neutron star are really ultra-high energy gamma rays, and that isn't going to produce your radio waves from neutron stars, which is what the pulsars produce, by and large. So something clever has to be done. Now, you know, for example, we discussed that, I think, yesterday afternoon, and we talked about ARCA, modified ARCA process. You know that a single photon cannot produce an electron-positron pair because you cannot satisfy energy and momentum conservation simultaneously. I said in the presence of a nucleus, a single photon can produce an electron-positron pair. In the same way, instead of a nucleus, a photon can create an electron-positron pair if there is a strong magnetic field. Basically, the magnetic field lines have tension. So if I pull a magnetic field line, it'll begin to oscillate. There's tension. Therefore, magnetic field lines in principle are sinks and donors of momentum and energy, just as a nucleus can do that. Okay? So what I'm saying is that an electron in the a photon in a magnetic field can produce an electron-positron pair without any problem satisfying energy and momentum conservation. The reason why you normally don't talk about it is worth appreciating. Now, the formula for the mean free path of the photon for pair production, that is, at that characteristic length, it'll produce a pair. The formula for the mean free path, according to quantum electrodynamics, is given there. I'm sure you can't make head or tail out of that formula, which is why I keep telling you, please rewrite formulae like this. Dot, dot, dot. I couldn't care less about that. The important thing is that the mean free path is inversely proportional to the perpendicular component of the magnetic field and exponential to the power 1 over the frequency of the photon and the perpendicular component of the magnetic field. So you really have to have very high magnetic fields and very high frequencies before the mean free path becomes so small that a gamma ray photon can produce a pair. That electron radiates and produces a gamma ray, which produces a pair. And after 10 to the power 43 or 45 pairs are produced, this ultra-high energy gamma ray is degraded to radio wavelength, and then it sort of escapes. Okay. So the key to why a neutron star functions as a pulsar is you have to break down gamma rays to radio waves or optical visible wavelength and so on, for which you need pair production. And please remember that the electrons are rapidly moving at the speed of light. So this pair production must happen in a very small distance near the surface of the star. Therefore, the mean free path has to be extremely small. So that's why I emphasize that this characteristic field, which comes from quantum electrodynamics, is 4.4 into 10 to the power 13 Gauss. Okay. So what happens is, charges of one species will go towards the surface, charge of the other polarity will go outside. It doesn't matter to us whether the electrons go down or positrons go down. So there will be a relativistic wind from a neutron star. So here is a summary. Here is the field lines that close inside the light cylinder. So there is the co-rotating magnetosphere. And over here, there is a cascade of electron-positron pair production in the presence of a magnetic field. And that is how radio radiation from pulsars are produced. So there ends the crash course on pulsars for you. Now, we are more interested in what happens to the pulsar later on in its life. First, we want to know what happens to the pulsars. So look at the equation at the bottom. The energy that is radiated by a neutron star comes at the expense of the stored rotational energy. Remember, you cannot extract energy from a DC magnetic field. So the energy is coming at the expense of half I omega squared. Therefore, the rate of change of half I omega squared with a minus sign is the luminosity of the neutron star, which, as I said, is proportional to b squared omega to the power 4. This is magnetic dipole radiation. Now, I can solve that equation. This is I omega omega dot is omega to the power 4. Therefore, omega dot is proportional to omega cube, which can be rewritten as the period derivative is proportional to b squared over p. In other words, a rotating neutron star will slow down. The rate of slowing down will be proportional to the square of the magnetic field and inversely proportional to the period. So the faster it spins, faster it will slow down. Higher is the magnetic field, faster it will slow down. So what I have shown on the top is the y-axis is the logarithm of the magnetic field of the neutron star, and x-axis is the logarithm of the periods, and plotted over here are 500 observed neutron stars. Today we have 2,500 neutron stars, but I don't have the data to make a plot like this. I wouldn't even know how to make a plot like this. So this is an older slide that I happen to have. So I, by the way, we have now 2,500 neutron stars in the sun. So if a neutron star were born with a very high magnetic field, then p dot will be very large because b squared comes in the numerator. So it will slow down, and then rate of slowing down will decrease. Rate of slowing down will decrease because the period is lengthening. This is period in the x-axis. Whatever it is, this high field pulsar will race from here to over there. Whereas a lower field pulsar, because b is small, will slow down at a smaller rate. That's why this length of arrow is smaller than the length of that arrow. And it'll take forever to reach there. Therefore, even though all these pulsars born spinning very fast, once every 25 or 30 years, you find that almost all of them are sitting over here in this diagram because they move very quickly. They move very quickly to the place, okay? So this is how pulsars evolve. But you notice that there are not many pulsars with period more than a couple of seconds. So pulsars seem to turn off, they seem to die. Why they die? I told you the reason is if the as the neutron star slows down, you notice neutron stars always moving right in this direction. As they slow down, the voltage generated by the dynamo decreases. At some stage, that voltage will go below the critical value needed for this pair production. And the pulsar will simply switch off. It's still a rotating neutron star, but it's just not producing radiation. Okay, it can produce low frequency magnetic dipole radiation at the same frequency as the rotation, but that's not what we see. Okay? So here is a plot. So what I'm suggesting is the neutron stars are born over there. They move in that direction. Eventually, their magnetic fields may also decay. And then when they cross a magical period, the voltage they generate reduces below a critical value and they will die. You notice there are no pulsars to the right of that line. That line is not a line that I drew. That is a theoretically predicted line. And what is that line? You remember I told you that the voltage generated by dynamo is proportional to b squared over p. And that voltage I'm putting equal to a critical value for pair production. So isn't it impressive that this theoretically predicted line explains why there are no pulsars to the right? Okay? I'll show you in the end this plot which I took from the web a couple of days ago, which has 2,500 pulsars, you'll still find there's not a single pulsar to the right of this line. Okay, now let's switch story. In 1974, which is closer to the theme of this summer school, Joe Taylor in Princeton, at that time he was not in Princeton, he was in the University of Massachusetts, with his student Hulse, discovered a very remarkable pulsar. This pulsar was in a binary system. And it was very clear its orbital period was incredibly short, only about 7.7 hours. The orbit was highly eccentric. Eccentricity was 0.6. The mass of the pulsar was 1.4 solar mass, and the mass of the companion was also 1.4 solar mass. Now, in a Kepler problem, you cannot solve for the masses because you don't know the inclination of the orbit. If you knew the inclination of the orbit, Kepler problem tells you how to solve for the mass. But we don't know the inclination. But fortunately, because you have two massive objects going around each other at a very short distance, which is only one solar radius apart, there'll be, you expect general relativistic effects to be very strong. And there are various general relativistic effects that come into play. And therefore, in addition to Kepler's equation, you have the relativistic equations. So using those, you can solve for the mass. And that is how the mass of the pulsar and the companion was deduced. And it can be measured to several decimal places. For example, the precession of the perihelion of the orbit was measured, and it was a huge effect. If you remember, for Mercury, it is 43 seconds of arc per century. Here, it is 4.2 degrees per year. And similarly, all these other effects, gravitational redshift, Shapiro delay, all these effects were very quickly measured using this binary pulsar. Perhaps the most important new result that came out and was the measurement of the decrease in the orbital size or change in the orbital period due to the emission of gravitational radiation. Now, what is plotted here is the solid curve is the formula that I wrote before, which is called as the quadrupole formula, taken from Landau and Lipschitz. And this is the dots of the observed change in the orbital period over many years. And you see there is perfect agreement. Now, this is something for you to think about, because I remember when this data started coming, a lot of most distinguished relativists used to come to the Raman Institute. And the big argument was, is the quadrupole formula correct? Heated arguments, absolutely heated arguments. But then you see that it seems to capture the... We can talk in private why people felt this formula couldn't be right, okay? It's a different story altogether. Okay, so this is what led to the Nobel Prize for Hulse and Taylor. Fortunately, this time they didn't leave out the student, Hulse. He also received the Nobel Prize. Jocelyn Bell lost out on the Nobel Prize. Well, recently, just about a few years ago, another binary pulsar system was discovered. This time, you saw both neutron stars beam towards you. In the other Hulse-Taylor system, only one neutron star was beamed towards us, so we saw only one pulsar. Here you can see both pulsars. But the reason why I'm mentioning this is, this binary system is far more compact than the previous one. So you expect the general relativistic effects to be even more spectacular. To such an extent, between morning and evening on any given day, you can measure all the general relativistic effects. Just, you don't have to wait for years. Between morning and evening, you can measure all the effects. Here, for example, the masses of the two pulsars are 1.4 solar mass, or thereabouts. Anyway, the point is, it is measured to three decimal places. The advance of the periastron, are you ready? 17 degrees per year. So in your lifetime, the ellipse will precess once fully, all right? You don't have to wait for millennia. The gravitational redshift is 0.4 milliseconds. Pound and Repka must be crying if they were still alive. The orbital decay is 7 millimeters per day. Yeah? Well, everything has been measured, geodetic precession, Shapiro delay. So I won't say anything further about this. Let's go back to the other relevant property of the pulsar, namely its period of rotation and its magnetic field. This caused a tremendous storm. Because you notice that the pulsar is spinning very fast. The fastest pulsar we knew at that time was the Crab pulsar, which was born in the year 1054. So you expect it to be spinning fast, 33 milliseconds period. This one was spinning at 59 milliseconds. Its magnetic field was very small, 3 times 10 to the 10 Gauss. Most of the pulsars have magnetic field above 5 times 10 to the power 12 Gauss. So this was 2.5 orders of magnitude smaller magnetic field. So you had a problem. By the way, in this talk, the rest of the thing that I'll talk about was almost exclusively work done at the Raman Research Institute. One of my former students, Deepankar Bhattacharya, now a very distinguished astrophysicist, works in Ayuka, collaborated with me in some aspects of this. And late Professor Radhakrishnan was also involved in some of these things. So I will not give any detailed references and so on. So this is a personal account, if you like. The point is that a very short period of 59 milliseconds suggested that this is a very young pulsar. And yet a very low magnetic field suggested that it was an old pulsar. So you could say, why couldn't it be a coincidence that God made this pulsar with a low magnetic field? But then there was an additional coincidence. How come this is the only pulsar that was in a binary system? Okay. So then those of you who are fond of reading Agatha Christie's story, Miss Marple would be very unhappy. One coincidence is okay, but two coincidences, something is wrong. Okay. All right. So the idea that was suggested by us is that what we are looking at is the following. The Hulse-Taylor pulsar was born like any other pulsar. It died a natural death like any other pulsar. And there it was happily buried in the graveyard. But much later, it was sort of spun up to a very short period. This was the idea, okay? This idea has come to be known as recycling of pulsars. So let us develop this idea, because the reason why I want to do that is I'm interested in spinning up a neutron star, because gravitational waves, at some stage, gravitational waves may become important from isolated neutron stars. So I'm telling this story mainly to tell you the story of how to spin up a neutron star and what will stop it. What is the limiting period? Okay. All right. So to make a rapidly rotating pulsar with a weak magnetic field, two things must happen. The magnetic field must die from its original value of several times 10 to the power 12 Gauss. Secondly, the neutron star has to be spun up. You will hear a lot about this next week, so I will not dwell on this, except to say that the majority of massive stars that you see in the sky, 60-70% of them are binary systems. And if you take two binary systems with two stars which are 25 and 10 solar mass, for example, then from Eddington's theory, you know the more massive star will evolve fast and will become a neutron star. It turns out that the supernova explosion will not disrupt the binary. At some stage, the second star also will evolve. And as it evolves and becomes a giant, it will transfer matter to the neutron star, and the neutron star will manifest itself as an X-ray source. That's why I'd given you that as a problem, to convince yourself it'll come in X-rays. And because this matter is coming from a companion star, it brings with it orbital angular momentum, and therefore it'll spin up the neutron star. You don't have to worry about whether the neutron star is spinning in the opposite direction or not, because this lever arm is so large that the orbital angular momentum is so enormous that even if the neutron star was spinning the other way, it'll quickly make it spin its way, okay? So it's, the original direction of angular momentum is irrelevant. Okay. Now, so this is the summary. The first bond, so the first bond, Remember, your binary system is produced two neutron stars. The Hall-Steiner system is two neutron stars. The claim is that this pulsar that you are seeing, the Hall-Steiner pulsar, is the first born neutron star. Nobody told you this, but that is the conjecture. It is the first born neutron star which would have undergone all this interesting history. Okay, now how do you spin up a neutron star? I said matter comes from the companion. Because the matter has angular momentum, it cannot fall in radially into a neutron star. It will form an accretion disk. And then due to friction, viscosity, etc., which is still totally ununderstood, matter comes from the inner edge of the accretion disk and falls on the neutron star, spinning it up or slowing it down or whatever may be the case. Why is there an inner edge to the accretion disk? Why doesn't the accretion disk touch the star itself? That's because the star has a strong magnetic field. As long as the energy density of the particles is larger than b squared over 8 pi, the particles will disobey the magnetic field. They will cross the magnetic field lines. But at some radius, the energy density of the particle will become equal to b squared over 8 pi at that distance. And then the magnetic field will say stop. That radius is known in the literature as Alfvén radius. Alfvén got the Nobel Prize for his discussion of magnetic fields of stars. And that Alfvén radius, which is a problem I've given for you to do this afternoon, is the radius at which the magnetic pressure, which is b squared over 8 pi, is equal to the ramp pressure, rho v squared. Now, convince yourself that that Alfvén radius is proportional to b to the power 7 to the power 12 by 7, and accretion rate m dot to the power minus 2. So that's the little problem for you. The problem is very straightforward. Calculate when this pressure will become equal to this pressure. When you solve that equation, you will get this. Okay? So it's a little exercise for you to do. Fine. Once the matter has been arrested with a magnetic field will say, come, let's co-rotate with the star. Because the magnetic field is co-rotating with the star. It is anchored to the star. But it's not that simple. This particle not only has to obey the magnetic field, it has to obey Mr. Kepler. Because according to Kepler's laws, there is such a thing as a co-rotation radius, that green circle. Co-rotation radius is the one at which the angular frequency of the orbit is equal to the angular frequency of rotation of the central object. The radius at which we put our communication satellites. If I make matter co-rotate at a larger radius, centrifugal force will dominate and the matter will be thrown back. If I make matter co-rotate at a smaller radius, gravity is stronger, so the matter will fall in. So whether the infalling matter is thrown back, when it's thrown back, it will extract angular momentum. If there's a ceiling fan, like in the cafeteria, if I throw tennis balls at it, the tennis ball will be flung apart. It didn't have angular momentum when I threw it, but it will have angular momentum when it's thrown out. Where did that angular momentum come from? From the propeller. Okay? Or if the matter falls in, it will spin up the ceiling fan. Right? So, in order to be able to do that, there has to be an interplay between the magnetic field and accretion so that the radius at which the neutron magnetic field stops the arrest is not that radius, blue radius, is not that blue radius, but it is that green radius. Therefore, in order for stable accretion, the co-rotation radius must be equal to the Alfvén radius. When that happens, you will get an equilibrium period. So that's what I've indicated. If it is not equal, the star will slow down, spin up, till it will finally come to an equilibrium period. Now that equilibrium period is obtained simply by equating the alpha n radius to the co-rotation radius. So that is the second exercise I've given you to do. And when you do that, you'll see that the equilibrium period is proportional to b to the power 6 over 7. And m, these radius and mass are irrelevant for us, m dot to the power minus 3 over 7. So the equilibrium period depends on the magnetic field of the neutron star. It depends on the accretion rate onto the neutron star. Right? So in case you're confused about this, please remember the equilibrium period is reached when the Keplerian period at the inner edge of the accretion disk is equal to the period of rotation of the central star. Okay? So what I'm saying is, if the Earth had an accretion disk, you put insat somewhere else, it'll come down to the inner edge of the accretion disk where the Keplerian period is equal to the period of rotation of the Earth. So that's the equilibrium period. Think a little bit more about it. It's a very elementary concept. So the idea advanced was that the Hulse-Taylor pulsar is the first-born neutron star in the binary system. The other one is pointing somewhere else in the galaxy. It was spun up to an equilibrium period. Remember, the equilibrium period depends on the magnetic field. So it is a line here, b to the power 6 over 7. But this pulsar has a particular magnetic field. So appropriate to that particular magnetic field, it is spun up to this period. Okay. So this is the prediction. If this prediction is correct, then the pulsar must be very close to this line observationally. So here is a summary of what I have said. The equilibrium period is just the Keplerian period at the inner edge of the accretion disk. The equilibrium period is proportional to the strength of the magnetic field and inversely proportional to the accretion rate m dot. So let us say that the blue line is a particular value of m dot, then that blue line is this equilibrium period, p equilibrium period, which is a function of the magnetic field. That's why it's not a unique point on the x-axis. But if the accretion rate is at m dot, which is the green m dot, then the equilibrium period line will be this. So if I go on increasing the accretion rate for a given magnetic field, I can spin up a star faster and faster and faster and faster to shorter and shorter and shorter periods. And if the magnetic field is low, then I can spin it up to even shorter and shorter and shorter period. The question is there a limit to this? So this plot, there is a particular value of the accretion disk. I'm saying if the magnetic field of the neutron star were high, then you'll spin it up to this period. If it was low, you'll spin it up to this period. Okay, fine. So now the question is, for a given magnetic field, let's take the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. Its magnetic field is 3 times 10 to the power 10 Gauss. Can I spin it up indefinitely by increasing the accretion rate? So that's the value of the magnetic field. Can I go on spinning it up to shorter and shorter period? The answer is no. And so here I want to digress for 2-3 minutes and tell you about one of the most important results in all of astrophysics. And it is worth understanding this. This is the concept of the Eddington luminosity limit. This is there in Eddington's book of 1923. So imagine you have a star like the Sun, which is a big object. Somewhere inside, I consider a unit volume of stellar matter. It is pulled by gravity, which is interior to it, which are the red arrows, and it is being pushed out by gas pressure and radiation pressure. Let's assume that gas pressure is not important, radiation pressure is important, because we are now going to be talking of radiation. What is the force of radiation acting on this unit volume? Now, if the luminosity of the star is L, the luminosity of a star is generated at the center, we know that. And if R is the radius of this imaginary sphere, then the luminosity, the radiative force is L divided by 4 pi r squared c into the cross section, into the area of this, if you like. Yeah? Force per unit area will be the pressure. So all I'm saying is that the radiation pressure per unit area or the radiation force is L divided by 4 pi r squared c n sigma Thomson. What is that? Let there be n electrons, let there be n electrons and n protons in that cube. So yesterday's discussion. As far as radiation is concerned, protons are unimportant. Because I have to wiggle the proton and the electron, a proton being 2,000 times heavier, I can wiggle electrons more easily. So Thomson scattering cross-section of the proton will be 2,000 times less. So let's consider only electrons. Each electron has a cross-section, sigma Thomson, and there are n electrons, so this is the total cross-section. What is the Thomson scattering cross-section? For your memory, I'll recall for you that sigma is 8 pi by 3 square of the classical radius of the electron, and the classical radius of the electron is defined to be that value such that the electrostatic energy is equal to the rest mass energy of the electron. This is all old, late 19th century physics, right? Now the gravitational force on that unit volume, like again in our discussion yesterday, radiation acts only on the electrons, but gravity acts only on the protons. It acts on the electron, but it's unimportant, right? So when I calculate the gravitational force on the unit volume, that is gm multiplied by n into mp, where mp is the number of protons inside that, divided by r squared. So for radiative equilibrium, this gravitational force acting on that unit volume must be equal to the radiative force acting on that unit volume. I can solve this for the luminosity, and what you find is that the luminosity is proportional apart from fundamental constants. Remember, sigma Thomson is also made up of fundamental constants. The luminosity is proportional only to the mass, only to the mass, nothing else. Don't care about the radius of the star, temperature of the star, nothing. It depends only on the mass of the star. So, that luminosity is called as the Eddington luminosity limit. If I, for one solar mass, it can be written as L, putting in values of all these constants, Eddington luminosity limit can be written as 10 to the power 38 Erg per second into mass in units of the solar mass. That is just a way to remember this formula. It is this argument that led to the idea that quasars must be powered by supermassive black holes. Because quasars have a luminosity of 10 to the power 46 Erg per second. So if the luminosity of the, we don't know what these quasars are. I don't care what it is. If this number is to be 10 to the power 46, this M has to be 10 to the power 8 or 9. So that was the argument that told people that what is powering the quasars must be a supermassive object. And then something else like variability said it has to be smaller than this. So if you put that much mass and that much small volume, it has to be a black hole, okay? So that's where, so this Eddington luminosity limit is a very powerful argument. And this is the argument that I invoked in this context. What we are saying is that when matter falls on the neutron star, it will emit X-rays. The luminosity generated is proportional to the accretion rate. There has to be a limit on the accretion rate because there is a limit on the luminosity. Because if I try to accrete more, the luminosity generated will be so large, it will just blow apart the matter. It won't allow it to rain. Okay, there is an umbrella there, which is being pushed below, from below by photons, right? So that is the idea. So the idea is that there is an upper limit to the accretion rate because there is an upper limit to the luminosity, and therefore there is a lower limit to the equilibrium period. So here it is summarized. The lower limit to the equilibrium period is defined by the upper limit to the accretion rate which is given by the Eddington luminosity limit. That is a number, 10 to the power 17 grams per second. It's as simple as that. It depends on no adjustable parameter, only on fundamental constants. There are no adjustable parameters in this theory. Okay, so remember our equilibrium period was b to the power 6 over 7, m dot to the power minus 3 over 7. Now I put the maximum possible value of m dot into that, and the equilibrium period, written in simple unit, is 1.9 milliseconds, b to the power 6 over 7, measured in units of 10 to the power 9 Gauss. So the idea is, this line cannot be pushed arbitrarily to the left. There is a brick wall, and that brick wall is provided by Eddington luminosity limit. So let's apply this to the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. So to summarize, for a given magnetic field strength, can a neutron star be spun up to arbitrarily short periods by increasing the accretion rate? No, there is an upper limit to the accretion rate determined by the upper limit to the luminosity generated, namely the Eddington luminosity limit. So the idea is that if this recycling idea is correct, then the Hulse-Taylor pulsar must be close to this line, and it is. You notice it's far from all other pulsars, but where it is very close to this line. So this gave some support to this idea of spinning up a neutron star. Remember, there was also a secondary prediction here. Namely, the first-born neutron star will experience all these exotic things, but the second-born neutron star will be just like any other 2,500 pulsar, because when it was born, everything is gone, there is no spinning up, there is no, the companion is another rock there, a neutron star, nothing can happen to it. So the prediction is that the second-born neutron star will be an ordinary, uninteresting, high-field, long-period pulsar, okay? Just like any other pulsar. So this remained as a prediction from 1978 till very recently when this pulsar was discovered. So there you see one pulsar is spinning very fast, 22 milliseconds. Its field is very low, 10 to the power 9 Gauss. The other pulsar is spinning with a period of 3 seconds. Its magnetic field is very high. So you have the first-born pulsar experiencing recycling. The second-born pulsar is as it was when it was born, okay? So it took a long time to verify this, but it's nice to see. So now let us go to another interesting story. Exactly 35 years ago, the fastest pulsar was discovered. It was spinning with a period of 1.5 milliseconds. The telegram announcing its discovery said that its magnetic field is 10 to the power 12 Gauss, which would imply its period derivative is very, very large, 10 to the power minus 14 seconds per second, which is the period derivative of most pulsars, like the Crab pulsar. Period derivative is 5 times 10 to the power minus 14 seconds per second. But it was a solitary pulsar. It was not a binary pulsar. It was just a solitary pulsar. Now, we were very intrigued by it, and we said, this can't be so. This must be a recycled pulsar like the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. It must have been spun up in a binary. Its magnetic field cannot be 10 to the power 12 Gauss. Remember, if you say it's a spun up pulsar, then the equilibrium period tells you what its magnetic field ought to be. So the statement was the measured magnetic field was simply wrong by many orders of magnitude. What about, why, how come it doesn't have a companion? Well, we just said the companion must have been blown away. So here it is, the logarithm of the magnetic field versus period. Here is our critical equilibrium period line. Here is the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, where it ought to be. And this is where this pulsar was when it was announced, the discovery was announced. And the prediction is that if it is a recycled pulsar, please remember, the period to which it will be spun up depends on how much its magnetic field has decayed. If the magnetic field has decayed this much, its period will be that. If the magnetic field has decayed that much, its period will be that. So the prediction was that this pulsar really ought to be sitting on this line if it is a recycled pulsar. If it is sitting on this line, its magnetic field should be 5 × 10⁸ Gauss and not several times 10⁻¹² Gauss, 4 orders of magnitude smaller. So the prediction was that it was earlier in a binary, its magnetic field today must be 5 × 10⁸ Gauss, and its period derivative cannot be 10⁻¹⁴, but must be 10⁻¹⁹ seconds per second. Some 4 or 5 months after these predictions were made in Jodrell Bank, they measured more accurately the P dot. It was 1.2 × 10⁻¹⁹, and the magnetic field was 4.7 × 10⁸ Gauss. And the pulsar was exactly there. So the period of this pulsar is that the period derivative is this, known to incredible accuracy. The predicted P dot was 1.2 × 10⁻¹⁹. The measured P dot was 1.1 × 10⁻¹⁹. Now, I don't know if I'll have time in the end, but let me point this out right now. The period of this pulsar is now known to 17 decimal places. It is known only to 17 decimal places because the second is defined only to 17 decimal places. The second is defined by 3 atomic clocks, one in Washington, D.C., one in Paris, and one in Stuttgart. And every day they are compared, intercompared. Now, atomic clocks, although extremely accurate, are subject to Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Therefore, their noise is stochastic. Therefore, you cannot predict what the atomic clock would do in the month of, say, September. But I know exactly what this millisecond pulsar will do. Yes, it's slowing down. This is an old value. I looked it up. Now, P dot is now measured to 12 decimal places. I know exactly the rate at which it is slowing down. So I can tell you the rate at which this millisecond pulsar will spin millions of years from now. So every day, this pulsar is compared with the 3 atomic clocks to calibrate the atomic clocks themselves for long-term stochastic variance. And since looking at the clock, my time is only 24 minutes or so left, let me say it right here. Today, 6 pulsars are known like this, with this kind of accuracy. Because you know the period to very great accuracy, you know exactly when a pulse should arrive, not here on Earth, but in the barycenter of the solar system. Because please remember, the Earth is rotating, therefore there'll be a Doppler effect. The Earth is moving around the Sun, there'll be a Doppler effect. Okay, the Sun is moving in the galaxy, there'll be a Doppler effect. Then there are Shapiro delays and Einstein delays and all kinds of general relativistic. You have to put in all those things, and if you go to the barycenter, I know exactly when these pulses ought to come. And every pulse from these pulsars has been timed in various observatories. So imagine around the Earth there are 4 or 5 millisecond pulsars like this. And then comes a primordial gravitational wave, and these pulsars move. And therefore, the distance between us and the pulsars will be modulated. Therefore, there is an array of millisecond pulsars which will be used as a detector of the stochastic gravitational wave, ultra-low frequency gravitational waves. Okay? So it's a very interesting thing that millisecond pulsars are turning out to be useful clocks from that point of view. I really wanted to tell you about this array, but I don't think I'll have time tomorrow to deal with that. So the conjecture was that somehow wave your hands and say the companion must have been blown away. Many years later, in 1988, another millisecond pulsar was discovered, which was found to be doing exactly that. there was a low mass white dwarf companion. It was an eclipsing pulsar. You actually could see the pulsar radiation. Remember, pulsar radiation, relativistic wind and hard radiation is blowing away this companion. So after several tens of millions of years, this companion simply won't exist. Okay? This is the pulsar. So that is not exactly a wild conjecture. The other predictions that were made a long time ago, 30 years ago, is that the majority of millisecond pulsars will be in binaries, even though the first one was not. They will be in incredibly circular orbits. They will all have magnetic fields of the order of 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss, and their periods will be between 6 and 10 milliseconds. So, to summarize those predictions, all the millisecond pulsars should be over there. They were born, they were recycled and brought to this line and released from that line, and they're slowing down. Over billions of years, they will move to the right. And so they won't be found exactly there, but they will be found somewhere over there. So that was the prediction made more than 30 years ago. And here is the latest data. This has 2,600 pulsars. And these are the millisecond pulsars. Circle there. There are 103 millisecond pulsars in this. They're all in binaries. Their magnetic fields are 5 times 10 to the power 8 Gauss. And that line is the equilibrium spin-up line over there. Okay. So, but how did the magnetic field get to be so low? You have to have an explanation for this. Now, what is the magnetic field of a neutron star due to? The simplest idea is to say it is just that the fossil field amplified due to collapse. Now, people have tried to generate magnetic fields of neutron stars after their birth, but these things simply don't work. It was predicted before by Ginsburg and Wolzer, before pulsars were discovered, that their magnetic field should be of the order of 10 to the power 12 Gauss. But here are the facts. Young pulsars seem to have high magnetic field, 12 to now 14 or so. Old pulsars have low magnetic field, and these old pulsars are all in binaries. So we have this strange thing, and also new evidence suggests that there is no evidence of field decay in solitary neutron stars in 10 to the 8 years or 10 to the 9 years. So you have this very strange situation that low magnetic fields occur only in binary systems. They don't seem to occur in... Now, how do you make the magnetic field decay? There is a serious problem in physics here. The poloidal magnetic field is produced by toroidal currents inside. So to kill the magnetic field, you have to kill these currents, and that you can do by ohmic dissipation. But if you estimate the ohmic dissipation timescale, that turns out to be 10 to the power 13 years. So you can't make the magnetic field decay in the age of the universe. Therefore, if the interior of the neutron star was not a superfluid or superconductor, that isn't going to help you one bit. You can't kill the magnetic field. Now, the idea is, as I said yesterday, the interior is a superconductor, and the superconductor will be in a vortex state, with each vortex having a quantum of flux, hc by 2e, just as we talked yesterday of quantum of circulation. How do we know these vortices arise? Here is an actual sample of a magnetic field applied to a type 2 superconductor, and you see these vortices. And this was predicted by Abrikosov, another student of Landau, in 1958, and he shared the Nobel Prize with Ginsburg a few years ago for this. But the problem is, it's a well-known property of a superconductor that the time scale for expelling a magnetic field from a superconductor is even longer, is 10 to the power 23 years. So there is a serious problem. How do you kill the magnetic field of a neutron star? You can't do it in classical physics, you can't do it in quantum physics, okay? But solitary neutron stars show no evidence of field decay. Why do low field pulsars always occur in binaries? How does the field decay, and why is there a limiting field? Why doesn't it all disappear? So the conjecture, or the idea that was advanced some 27 years ago, so you remember that the protons form a superconductor and there are proton vortices parallel to the magnetic field. There are neutron vortices parallel to the rotation axis. These are the Feynman vortices. These are the abacus of vortices. So the neutron star really has two kinds of spaghettis in it, the red spaghettis and the green spaghettis. And the argument is that these spaghettis stick to one another. I don't have time to go into the physics of this, but there's sound physics, very sound physics, to argue that they'll be strongly interpinned. We'll return to that in a minute. So the idea is, as the neutron star slows down, either because of its radiation or because I apply brake on it, the Feynman vortices will have to go out and annihilate, because the angular velocity of rotation tells you exactly how many vortices there ought to be. But they are tangled up with these magnetic vortices, so they will drag the magnetic field out. So you don't have to have spontaneous expulsion of the magnetic field. So I have a fishing rod with which I pull out these spaghettis. So as the Feynman vortices go out, they will drag the flux tubes with them. Okay. Now, the point is, this will not work for an isolated neutron star, because an isolated neutron star does not slow down very much. It only slows down to 1 or 2 seconds, that's all. And its slowdown time scale will be, so the time scale for the field decay will be t to the power minus 1/4. But in a binary system, as you will hear next week, a neutron star can be braked to very large periods of hundreds and thousands of seconds. Remember, as I said, if you throw something at a ceiling fan, if the matter is thrown back, the ceiling fan will slow down. This effect was predicted by Sunyaev and his collaborators a long time ago, almost 40 years ago. And this is seen. For example, these red objects are neutron stars on which matter is coming from a companion star. And they have been braked to, look at those periods, hundreds and thousands of seconds. So the idea is, during this time is when the flux is expelled. That is why magnetic field decay occurs only in neutron stars which have undergone this binary history. They do not occur in solitary neutron stars. Okay? So the prediction here is, if the companion is massive, like in a Hulse-Taylor pulsar, then there is less time for magnetic field, I mean the neutron star, to be spun down. It is only spun down to that period, whereas in a low-mass binary, it's spun down to a much larger period. And the idea is that the asymptotic field of the neutron star will be inversely proportional to the period to which it was spun down. And that prediction is now spectacularly confirmed. You see, there are two kinds of recycled pulsars. These have a magnetic field of 5 times 10 to the 8 or thereabouts. These are the millisecond pulsars with low mass white dwarf companions. These are the Hulse-Taylor-like binary pulsars. Many of them have been found now. Their fields are larger. So there are two classes of recycled pulsars, very clearly seen in this plot, which has almost 2,700 pulsars in it. Now, I want to end in another 10 minutes by going closer to the theme of this workshop, summer school. Before that, I want to set the stage by saying, if all this flux spinning and dragging is true, something interesting will happen. You know, the roof of this building is concrete and there are reinforcing rods. The question is, pull on the iron rods, will it rip through the concrete, or will it break off a chunk of concrete along with it? That depends on the cohesive strength of the concrete, and it depends on the force with which the rods are attached to the concrete. So here my concrete is the crustal matter, and the iron rods and my reinforcing rods are the magnetic flux tubes which are anchored to it. I am pulling on the flux tubes with my Feynman Onsager vortices. And the question is, what will happen to the crust? Is it like cutting a cake? Will the knife simply come through? Or it's like in the old days you used to cut soap with thread. Will the soap also come along with it, a chunk of soap, right? Now, very careful analysis of this by what is shown here is what happens to a real solid. When you subject a solid to a displacement, it fractures in a, this is called serrated yielding. It doesn't simply yield. It yields in an almost periodic manner. This is called serrated yielding. So the idea is that because of this, the neutron star will actually be broken up into a large number of plates like the, we have on Earth, the continents or the plates. And these plates will move, due to slowing down, these plates will move towards the equatorial region, which is the subduction zone. There they will go into the star, melt, and then come out in the pole. These are all well-known ideas from terrestrial plate tectonics. Okay, these are all borrowed ideas from there. But nevertheless, the idea is that over these millisecond pulsars, which are the ones of interest in the context of gravitational radiation from isolated neutron stars, the surface is more likely to be like a cracked hard-boiled egg. And this has implications for raising tides on the neutron stars in a binary system, and it also has other possibilities of gamma ray emission and so on, which we do not know. So let me now, in the remaining 8 minutes, turn to, you know, remember impedance matching transformers, they used to call them in electronics, to match impedances of equipment. So I'm now going to, in the last 5 minutes or so, attempt to impedance match with Professor Andersson's lecture. I don't know what he's going to talk about, but I saw the outline in the web based on that. So now what we have discussed is we were trying to spin up a star. And we hit a brick wall, and that brick wall was the Eddington luminosity limit. The question is there another brick wall? And is the other brick wall over here or over here? If it's over here, see, already we have 1.5 milliseconds. If it's over here, then it's great for gravitational radiation, right? Because omega triple dot whole squared. So, okay. Now, bear with me for a minute. For a neutron star of a given mass, this is the same thing. In the spin-up scenario, the minimum period is determined by the Eddington rate. Now, but it could also be that the spin-up is terminated by instabilities arising due to rotation itself. Mass shedding at the Kepler limit is an example. If I spin up a Newtonian star, there is a Kepler limiting frequency at which mass will be shed from the equator, right? But we are interested in asking this question in the framework of general relativity now. So what we are interested in is, will there be non-axisymmetric instabilities that set in spontaneously, and what drives these instabilities? And I want to tell you about two very, very remarkable discoveries which tell you that these instabilities may be driven by gravitational radiation itself. The first discovery was made by Chandrasekhar in 1970. Now, before that, some preliminaries. It's well known that Newtonian stars that rotate sufficiently rapidly are unstable to a bar mode instability with m equal to 2. These are non-axisymmetric modes. So what is plotted here is the angular velocity as a function of eccentricity, and this sequence of the Maclaurin spheroids, studied by Maclaurin at the time of Newton. Now you notice there is this point where there is a bifurcation. This is the point at which this bar mode instability occurs at this point of bifurcation, where the Maclaurin spheroids become unstable to Jacobi ellipsoid. These ellipsoids are like rugby ball. They have the contour is an ellipse both in this direction and in this direction. So they are the ones that will be interesting for gravitational radiation. Now, in models of stars, which are not perfect fluids, but which have viscosity, this bifurcation occurs at a slower rotation rate. It doesn't even happen to be, if there is no viscosity, if it's a perfect fluid, this bifurcation occurs only for very rapidly spinning. But if there is viscosity, it can occur in more interesting, slower spinning object also. Now here it is. These Jacobi triaxial ellipsoids are static in the rotating frame. In other words, in the inertial frame, they are really rugby balls which are rotating. And therefore will emit gravitational radiation. Now, Chandrasekhar showed in 1969 that this instability is suppressed by radiation reaction to emission of gravitational waves. In other words, we have forgotten gravitational radiation. So if you include gravitational radiation, this instability goes away. So he wrote a paper in 1969. Within 1 week of that, he wrote a second paper in which he announced a very remarkable discovery. He says, no, there is an instability that arises precisely because of gravitational radiation. That instability doesn't take the Maclaurin spheroid into Jacobi ellipsoids, but it takes it into a different kind of ellipsoids, which are called the Dedekind ellipsoids, which were predicted in 1860 and been forgotten for 100 years. What is remarkable about this Dedekind ellipsoid, it's extremely exciting, is in the inertial frame, that rugby ball will not rotate at all. That's there on the tabletop. But internally, there is a vertical motion which is responsible for that ellipsoidal shape. Okay, so there are internal motions. The outside, so that's the point. The Dedekind ellipsoids are stationary in the inertial frame, whereas the Jacobi ellipsoids are rotating in the inertial frame. Anyway, the point is, this was the discovery Chandrasekhar made in 1970. In 1978, John Friedman, who was Chandrasekhar's student, made an even more remarkable discovery, and that was pursued by Friedman and Schütz. There was an initial communication in mathematics communication by Friedman, followed by a long scholarly paper by Friedman and Schütz that same year. What they discovered was that non-axisymmetric instability driven by gravitational radiation is not something special to these Dedekind ellipsoids, but they are generic in general relativity. In other words, all rotating bodies, including the Earth, is unstable in general relativity to non-axisymmetric instabilities which are driven by gravitational radiation. It is just that for objects like the Earth, that growth timescale is comparable to the age of the universe, therefore it's not end. Whereas if you have something like a millisecond pulsar, then you have interesting timescales. Okay. So how does this work? I have attempted a cartoon. Please listen to me carefully. If you don't understand, we'll discuss over coffee. So here is a neutron star which is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. There is a non-axisymmetric mode. Let's consider equal to two mode. There are two modes, one perturbation mode going in this direction, one going in this direction. The forward moving mode will have positive angular momentum with respect to us, and the backward moving mode will have negative angular momentum with respect to us. Okay? All right, fine. Everything clear? Okay. Gravitational waves will remove, remember this is now non-axisymmetric perturbation has come about. There will be gravitational waves which will remove positive angular momentum from this mode and will remove negative angular momentum from this mode. In other words, you will detect gravitational, two sets of gravitational waves, one with positive angular momentum and one with negative angular momentum, coming from two different perturbations. And therefore, both modes will be damped. Uninteresting. But imagine that this star is rotating very fast. Then there is inertial frame dragging. In a very rapidly rotating star, this backward moving mode will be dragged to the forward direction as far as an asymptotic observer is concerned due to inertial frame dragging. See the implication of this. The gravitational radiation will remove positive angular momentum from this mode also, because from infinity, that red mode is also now going in the forward direction due to frame dragging. So gravitational radiation will remove positive angular momentum from this mode, which has a negative angular momentum. So if you remove positive angular momentum from negative angular momentum, it will become more negative and more negative. In other words, gravitational radiation will drive this instability, which means that you can't spin it up beyond this limit. Okay? So that's the crux of this matter. Now, what is interesting is that the two of the fastest millisecond pulsars that we know have the same period to 3 seconds, 3% accuracy. This is extraordinary. It could be a coincidence, but why the hell should it be? Their magnetic fields are wildly different. How come their periods are exactly the same? So John Friedman and his collaborators suggested that this could be what you are really witnessing is a brick wall. This brick wall is a gravitational wave-driven instability. If that is so, this would imply a stiff equations of state for neutron stars. Where you put this brick wall, because this point of bifurcation will be decided by the internal equation of state. And this stiff equation of state would suggest a maximum mass of 2 solar mass. So the calculation by Friedman and his collaborators for all kinds of equations of state, what is plotted here is the angular velocity versus the ratio of the two energies, which is something like kinetic versus potential energy, which is written over there, rotational energy by potential energy. This terminal points or the Kepler frequencies at which there will be equatorial load shedding. This diagonal line is when the neutron stars will become unstable to this instability, and there is the period of rotation of the 2 millisecond pulsars. So only these two stiff equations of state L and M give you the brick wall at that period. So Friedman and his collaborators suggested that if you interpret that we don't, why is it we haven't found half a millisecond pulsar? 2,700 pulsars now. So if this interpretation is correct, then you have to conclude the equation of state is stiff. But please remember, there are many caveats. Viscosity can suppress this instability. But therefore, it's a competition. In a perfect fluid, the growth time of the unstable mode is the gravitational radiation reaction timescale, Chandrasekhar and Paul Esposito. Whereas viscous damping is determined by a different timescale. So it's a competition between these two timescales. Unfortunately, viscosity of neutron star matter is very poorly understood. It's a very difficult problem. And superfluidity of the interior complicates matter even further.